Why is there still debate about whether intermittent fasting works? Now, many of you may remember, it's been a long, hard slog for docs that are way deep into the science versus the docs that are just, you know, going through the motions every day, seeing as many patients as they can and writing prescriptions. You know, the right thing to do is to understand the science and to spend time talking about the fact that lifestyle is documented 3 times more effective than drugs, surgeries, supplements. You can't procedurize, you can't stent, you can't bypass, you can't supplement, you can't out-prescribe a lifestyle problem. And one of the major focuses on lifestyle, the major focus, far and away, is diet. Now, there's a lot to diet, and one of the things that has come up time and time again is this concept of intermittent fasting. In other words, going through a cycle of fasting plus feeding. As you begin to look at that science, to me, it's just been piling up year after year after year that it does help our body to go in cycles. One of the terms that you hear, when you hear the term intermittent fasting, most people basically, on a practical basis, mean skipping breakfast. There's a lot of other ways to do that. It's actually more healthy if you can skip dinner. But again, another way of looking at this daily intermittent fasting is time-restricted eating, TRE, closing that eating window. Walter Longo is one of the leaders in that space. So the day after Christmas, everybody was still, I think maybe most of us were overeating for the holidays, taking a little vacation. The New England Journal, the standard journal for the standard doc, it's going to be hard to argue with a New England Journal article at this point. That finally came out with a science review. And so what it said was, yeah, it works. It should become a part of the standard of medicine for standard recommendations for lifestyle management. So let's get to exactly what that said. Preclinical studies, clinical trials have shown that intermittent fasting has broad spectrum benefits for many health conditions. Eating in a 6-hour period and fasting for 18 hours can trigger a metabolic switch from glucose-based to ketone-based energy, increase stress resistance, increase longevity, bring physical and cognitive effects, benefits, decrease the incidence of diseases like cancer and obesity. In humans, the 3 most widely studied intermittent fasting regimens are alternate day fasting, 5-2 intermittent fasting, where you fast 2 days each week, and daily time-restricted eating. Now, here's one of the images out of that article. Intermittent fasting and the metabolic switch. Basically, glucose and fatty acids are the major sources for energy for our cells. After meals, glucose is used for energy. Fat is stored in adipose or fat tissue as triglycerides or fat. During periods of fasting, triglycerides are broken down into fatty acids and glycerol, which are used for energy. Fatty acids, glycerol, triglyceride, that's where it gets its name. The liver then converts fatty acids into ketone bodies, which provide a major source of energy for many tissues, especially the brain, during fasting. Ketone bodies are not just fuel used during periods of fasting. They're potent signaling molecules with major effects on cell and organ functions. They regulate the expression and activity of many proteins and molecules that are known to influence health and aging, like NAD+ and sirtuins. And we're not going to go down that bunny hole right now of defining those. We're going to assume that you're familiar with those. In other words, biomarkers, markers of metabolism. Ketone bodies have profound effects on systemic metabolism by influencing these major cellular pathways. In the fed state, not federal, but having eaten fed state, blood levels of ketone bodies are low. In humans, they rise within 8 to 12 hours after the onset of fasting. Benefits of intermittent fasting due to the metabolic switch include improvements in glucose regulation, blood pressure, heart rate, efficacy of endurance training, abdominal fat loss. In other words, just a whole bunch of really good things. So, intermittent fasting and stress resistance. Most, if not all, organ systems respond to IF in ways that enable the organism to tolerate and overcome the challenge and then restore homeostasis. In other words, health, a healthy state. Cells respond to IF by engaging in a coordinated adaptive stress response that leads to antioxidant defenses, DNA repair, protein quality control, mitochondrial biogenesis and autophagy. In other words, cleaning up those mitochondria, the powerhouse of the cell. Downregulation of inflammation. So decrease inflammation, improve mitochondrial health, improve protein quality, improve DNA, antioxidant defense. So a lot of really good things. IF stimulates autophagy and mitophagy. Now, wait a minute. Even if we know what autophagy is, auto, self, phagy, meaning to eat, the cell eating trash that it's created, what is mitophagy? Mitochondria. So what you're doing there with mitophagy is you're eating old, beat up mitochondria. While inhibiting the mTOR, remember that one? Mammalian target of rapamycin, protein synthesis pathway. We're not going to go down that bunny trail either. It's hard enough for me to keep on the straight path here. These responses enable cells to remove oxidatively damaged proteins and mitochondria and recycle undamaged molecular constituents while temporarily reducing global protein synthesis to conserve energy and molecular resources. Now, intermittent fasting and aging. After nearly a century of research on caloric restriction in animals, for example, mice, rats, monkeys, and humans, the overall conclusion was that reduced food intake robustly increases the lifespan. In humans, IF ameliorates obesity, insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, hypertension, and inflammation. Well, if you improve all those items, what do you think is going to happen to longevity? In one trial, 16 healthy participants on alternate day fasting for 22 days lost 2.5% of their initial body weight and 4% of fat mass. In other words, they're losing more fat, with a 57% decrease in fasting insulin levels. 57% decrease in fasting insulin. That's a big deal. In two other trials, overweight women were assigned to either a 5-2 IF regimen, intermittent fasting regimen, or a 25% reduction in daily caloric intake. So again, we've got intermittent fasting versus caloric restriction. The women in the two groups lost the same amount of weight during the 6-month period, but in the group assigned to the 5-2 intermittent fasting, in other words, fasting and then refeeding, fasting and refeeding, those women had a greater increase in insulin sensitivity and a larger reduction in waist circumference. Physical and cognitive effects of intermittent fasting. In animals and humans, physical and cognitive effects or functions are improved with IF. Young men who fast daily for 16 hours lose fat while maintaining muscle mass during 2 months of resistance training. In a clinical trial, older adults on a short-term regimen of caloric restriction had improved verbal memory. In a study involving overweight adults with mild cognitive impairment, 12 months of caloric restriction led to improvements in verbal memory, executive function, and global cognition. So even caloric restriction appears to be having significant improvement with cognitive performance in older adults. Now let's talk about obesity and diabetes. On the island of Okinawa, the traditional population typically maintains an IF regimen. Intermittent fasting has low rates of obesity, low rates of diabetes, and extreme longevity. You remember? Read the book, The Blue Zones, or just look it up on your computer or your iPhone. The Blue Zones. The archetypical blue zone is Okinawa. What's another one? Calabria, Italy, where Walter Longo was born. Okay, so members of the Caloric Restriction Society who follow the CRON, calorie restriction with optimal nutrition diet, have low rates of diabetes with low rates of IGF, growth hormone, and markers of inflammation and oxidative stress. Wait a minute, what's IGF-1? Insulin-like growth factor. Again, these are all things that increase cell growth. They also increase inflammation. And you get a decrease of that with both caloric restriction and with intermittent fasting. How about neurodegenerative disorders? Not so easy for me to say, huh? Epidemiological data suggests that excessive energy intake, particularly in midlife, increases the risk of stroke. In other words, taking too much energy, you weigh too much, increase the risk of stroke, Alzheimer's, and Parkinson's. Cancer. A trial of daily caloric restriction in men with prostate cancer showed excellent adherence, 95%. No adverse effects. Several case studies involving patients with glioblastoma. That's a very, very aggressive brain cancer. Killed my grandfather on my mother's side. It also killed a fellow named Frank Polk, who was the AIDS researcher that I worked with at Johns Hopkins. Several case studies involving patients with this suggest that intermittent fasting can suppress tumor growth and extend survival. Cardiovascular disease. IF improves multiple indicators of cardiovascular health in animals and humans like blood pressure, resting heart rate, HDL, LDL, triglycerides, glucose, and insulin. In addition, it reduces markers of systemic inflammation and oxidative stress associated with atherosclerosis. The calorie comprehensive assessment of long-term effects of reducing intake of energy calorie study showed that 12% reduction in daily calorie intake for 2 years improves cardiovascular risk factors. Now, why are we going through all these details? That's all known, right? As I said, and here's a spoiler alert, there was just an article recently that came out and said, maybe that's not true. We'll talk about it in just a minute, but let's just go into a little bit more here. So, a diet of 3 meals with snacks every day is so ingrained in our culture. A change in this eating pattern will rarely be contemplated by patients or docs. We need to change that. That's what the pro IF guys like myself would say. On switching to an IF regimen, many people will experience hunger, irritability, and a reduced ability to concentrate during periods of food restriction. However, these initial side effects usually disappear within a month, and patients should be advised of this fact. Most physicians are not trained to prescribe specific IF interventions. Physicians can advise patients gradually over a period of several months. Reduce the time window during which the patients consume food each day with the goal of fasting for 16 to 18 hours a day. Now so everybody's all happy, finally moving in the right direction with standardizing intermittent fasting. And here comes this study on September 28th of this year. Effects of time-restricted eating on weight loss and other metabolic parameters in women and men with overweight and obesity. The TREAT randomized clinical trial in JAMA Internal Medicine. And here's the link if you want to look it up. It was a 12-week randomized clinical trial, including 116 participants, 70 men, 46 women, 18 to 64, with BMIs between 27 and 43. Participants were randomized into consistent meal timing, CMT group, eating 3 structured meals per day, or the TRE group, time-restricted eating group, eat ad lib, you know, eat whenever you want, from 12 p.m. to 8 p.m., and completely abstain from 8 p.m. to 12 p.m. the following day. The primary outcome that they looked for was weight loss. Secondary outcomes were the things that we've been talking about. Changes in weight, fat mass, lean mass, fasting insulin, fasting glucose, A1C levels, estimated energy intake, in other words, how much total food are you eating, total energy expenditure, resting energy expenditure. Now, as you notice, there's not a whole lot about other markers like IGF-1 and that sort of thing. The conclusions on this study were TRE did not confer weight loss or cardiometabolic benefits, and TRE was associated with a moderate decrease in weight, but it was not significantly different from the decrease in the control group. What the heck are we supposed to make of that? Continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars, and here's why.
You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks. We continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars, and here's why. You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks.